Another sort of question that sort of relates to this is, and people ask this all the time, is what about people that are start eating later in the day? For example, they wake up 8 in the morning, but they don't eat until noon. So they, let's say they eat their first bite of food at noon, and they stop eating at 8 p.m. So that's 8 hour TRE eating window, and they go to bed by 11 or so. Do they still have the same benefits, or are they losing because it's like the circadian, the time restricted eating window is kind of shifted to later, and obviously there's a light darkness component to all this to some degree.
Yeah.
Do you?
So those questions, we haven't even teased them in animal models, but I'm sure some people will start teasing them apart. So what happens is in the morning, we know insulin sensitivity is at its best. So people who have a bigger meal earlier in the day, they have less insulin spike, less glucose spike, etc. Having said that, we don't know for people who are starting their food every day at noon whether their best insulin sensitivity is at noon or it actually happened at 8 o'clock in the morning. So that information we don't know. So this is where some study is needed in human volunteers who are doing this. And maybe some people who are eating, starting to eat at noon, one day they maybe they can drink a glass of juice at 8 o'clock and prick themselves, get a glucose reading and monitor themselves. And then another day, a week later at noon, they will eat the same glass of juice and prick themselves and see how is their glucose response. So that's a simple self-experimentation with some healthy people. If they're out there, then they can do that. And if they post it, that'll be really nice. Second thing is, what happens toward the end of the day or night? So this is where it becomes a little bit complicated because, as you said, there is day and night transition. And we know that in the evening, as our body prepares to sleep, our melatonin level begins to rise. And that melatonin usually rises 2 to 3 hours before our habitual sleep time. So if somebody is going to bed around 11, then that melatonin is beginning to rise around 9 o'clock. On an average, for some people it might rise around 4 hours early, and some people it will rise exactly at bedtime. And when melatonin rises, there is new data showing that melatonin can bind to its receptor in pancreas, and this engagement of melatonin with the pancreas receptor essentially tells the pancreas, okay, it's time to sleep. You don't have to bother releasing insulin. Mm-hmm. So in that way, what happens if somebody is having a big meal when there is high melatonin, then there may not be enough insulin released from pancreas and glucose may stay high in the blood circulation for a long time. And this study, these kind of studies came to publication because almost 10 years ago, large genome-wide association studies found that people with obesity or diabetes might have a mutation in melatonin receptor. And that was confusing because what is melatonin to do with obesity and diabetes? And you fast forward 10 years, people went back to the drawing board and looked at where the receptor is expressed and what it does when melatonin is engaged, and then they found out that there is this effect of melatonin on insulin. So that's why people who are eating late into the night, they may not get the best benefit in terms of glucose control because their glucose might remain slightly higher than if they had the same dinner 2 hours earlier.
If they're making more melatonin.
If they're making melatonin. Yeah. So it's very, so that's why I said it's complicated.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I would say eating randomly over 12 hours, 15 hours versus eating to this 8 hours, even that starts at noon, I will prefer the 8 hours starting at noon.
Right. So it seems like there's, in addition to, you know, the food, the timing of your food intake. So, you know, the first time you're eating sort of starts a lot of these liver enzymes and metabolism and glucose metabolism and all these things. In addition to that, that circadian rhythm being regulated by just the food intake, there's also this whole melatonin issue and the night daylight cycle, and you know when you're starting to make more melatonin, and all that complicates things as well.
Yeah,
it seems. I remember a study that was done where I think men were given the same caloric meal in the morning and the evening, and glucose was measured, and the blood glucose levels were much higher in the evening versus the morning. But of course, they could have been. Who knows how long, you know, was the morning like 8 a.m. and then they were doing, you know, 9 p.m. or 8, 7, who knows like what their timing window was, right?
I mean, the habitual meal, what was the habitual meal?
Right.
I mean, that's very well, very widely observed phenomena. And in fact, there was a term for that was called evening diabetes. So a person might be healthy in the morning based on blood glucose. In the evening, if you do the same postprandial glucose tolerance test and then look at the glucose level, then maybe diagnose diabetic.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
I think the other component to this would be the fasting component, right? So so people think, well, I'm only eating within an 8-hour window, so I have a much longer fasting period. And I think that's maybe uncoupling some of these differences between time-restricted eating, being on a circadian rhythm, and fasting, intermittent fasting, prolonged fasting, all these, you know, there's so many different terms out there.
Yeah.
That I think sometimes a lot of just all gets mushed together in one group and it's like all the same.
Yeah.
But it's not actually all the same.
No, it's not the same. So for example, even not having food in your system for 12 to 16 hours, whether it's fasting or not, that's debatable, because some people say, well, it's not fasting, it's not having food for 12 hours. I think that's where I would say not having food for 12 to 16 hours is not fasting, but maybe giving rest to your system. Rest and repair and rejuvenation of your system. So when we think about fasting, two things come to mind: feeling hungry. And feeling hungry has many different connotations, many different intensity. So one sense of feeling hungry is, well, you might feel light, and then second, your stomach may begin to rumble a little bit. And then I would say that is your stomach is telling, well, I'm repairing myself. You're not actually really hungry. You are not getting low energy that you cannot get up from the chair or run or something like that. And then after several, maybe 1 or 2 days of fasting, or maybe after 24 hours of fasting, some people will get a headache. So that's a good sign that, well, your brain is not getting enough energy in its habitual, usual form, and maybe trying to signal the rest of the body that the body has to send some other form of energy, for example, ketone bodies or something. So in that way, fasting, if you're measuring fasting, or if you're defining fasting in terms of ketone body formation above certain level, then that may kick in after 24 hours. Or if you have that threshold even much higher, then fasting maybe 48 or 72 or even 96 hours before you see that level of ketone body, that can be your definition of fasting. Mm-hmm. So in that way, I think the way you define fasting will determine whether 24 hours, 48 hours, 96 hours, or even 12 hours or 16 hours is fasting. But the way we think, we kind of define how many hours your system should not have food is based on our daily circadian rhythm, because if you think about what are the key elements to being healthy, it boils down to three important things. One is sleep, and the second one is nutrition or food, and then third one is physical activity. And these three are interlinked with each other. So for example, if somebody is sleep deprived or didn't have sleep, then it's very hard for that person to do physical activity next day or go on a marathon. So these two are interlinked. Similarly, if somebody is eating for 15, 16 hours and has a very heavy meal at the end of the day, then it affects sleep. It also affects physical activity. One cannot run with full stomach. So these three are interrelated. So on a daily basis, what we feel is having limiting food to 8 to 10 or maximum 12 hours helps to coordinate these three foundations of health to work on a daily basis and give us healthy benefit. So on a very simple sense, if I want to relate time-restricted eating and then maybe long-term fasting, 1 day of fasting, 2 days of fasting, or 4 days of fasting, which definitely have much more benefit, then it's almost like taking care of your teeth. So brushing every day is like time-restricted eating. That's the minimum one can do, and that's something necessary to take care of your teeth. But again, once in a while, maybe twice a year or three times a year or once a year, depending on how much you want to take care of your teeth, you want to go see a dentist. So that's almost like a prolonged fast one has to do once a year. So similarly, I do 4 to 5 days of water fasting only once a year, and that absorbs all the other sins with my feeding that I might have committed throughout the year. So in that way, I think the difference between time-restricted eating and other forms of fasting is one can adopt time-restricted eating as a true lifestyle, starting even from teenage or even toddler years, all the way through when you are 80, 90s, or even 100 year old. Whereas this long-term fasting, 2 days or 4 days of fasting, forget about even teenagers doing it. And some older people who are very fragile, they may not be able to do it. And you need medical intervention or some kind of supervision to do it. Many people who are slightly unhealthy, means even some diabetic who might go hypoglycemic after 10, 12 hours, type 2 diabetic, I mean, they may not be able to do it without medical supervision. So although those long-term fasting definitely have much benefit, and that has been shown in multiple studies, they need a certain, they can be practiced only by a certain type of people at certain age and need more mental resolve. And it may not be a everyday lifestyle, whereas time-restricted eating can be an everyday lifestyle.
That's a great way of putting it.